The title of my message today, Choose Wisely. Choose Wisely. And the text is taken from Ephesians chapter 5, 15 to 20. I'll read it to you once more. Ephesians chapter 5, verses 15 to 20. Be careful then how you live, not as unwise people, but as wise, making the most of time, because the days are evil. So do not be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is. Do not get drunk with wine, for that is debauchery, but be filled with the Spirit, as you sing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs among yourselves, and making melody to the Lord in your hearts, giving thanks to God the Father at all times and for everything in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, the passage is fairly simple and clear. We don't have to do much of explanation, but let me still go ahead and make a few comments. Brethren, this particular passage deals with, it contrasts two components. It contrasts wisdom and foolishness. Earlier in the chapter, in the same chapter, we had the contrast of love and lust. We had the contrast of light and darkness. Biblical writers use this technique known as antithetical parallelism to arrest the attention of the readers. This is one of the techniques. Just like today in our media or in advertising, we have various techniques. Those people use exaggeration or hyperbole or extremes to gain public attentions. And then let's look at another point. Let's look at verse 16. Verse 16 says, so do not be making the most of time, brethren, making the most of time, because the days are evil. One particular translation renders this as, so watch your steps, use your head. Paul is making it clear that we have to carefully consider our choices. We are encouraged to consider how we spend our time. And then it goes on to say, do not be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is. Reminds us that God, we are presented with opportunities, choices, both good and evil. And we must choose properly by thinking through the implications of what we do. At this point of time, let me tell you something. Making choices or human decisions involves two factors. There is the factor of emotions. There is the factor of reflection. When you want to make a choice, these two factors come into play and they interact among themselves. What happens normally is the emotional part is spontaneous and dominates, and it may not take into consideration the consequences of your decision. Therefore, the best way to arrive at a sound decision is to allow time and thought. When you allow time and thought, your decision gets tempered. The reflective component tempers the emotional component. For example, let me tell you, the emotional side tells me I want to eat ice cream, butterscotch ice cream. I'm sure all of you like it, but that's what the emotion says. But if you allow time and thought, the reflective side will tell you that ice cream is not helpful for your health in the long run. And therefore, you have to be careful what choices you make. And then it goes on to say, because emotional is always spontaneous and it dominates. And then moving to verse 18 and 20, we are encouraged not to drink too much of alcohol, as it leads to overindulgence in pleasing the self in sensual pleasures. This cheapens our life, impairing our judgment, leading to make unwise decisions, even affecting our speech. More importantly, it cheapens our view of ourselves and others. Drinking too much wine is a way where we make wrong choices. But brethren, there are other factors also that chip in, that clip, that come in, that affect our view. And then, like, if you don't have an empathy for others, and if you don't are open to new information, you become judgmental, and you have feelings of you don't make sound judgments about yourself or about others, and you feel superior. Now, verse 19, look at verse 19 and 20. It says, verse 19 says, be filled with the Holy Spirit and drink deeply drink deeply of all that is Jesus. Jesus is what he gives us, singing hymns and praises, making melody in our hearts. Brethren, the implication is that being in tune with the Holy Spirit guides us in making our choices and creates thanksgiving and joy. We treasure creation and have our eyes made open to see the goodness of the Father, Son, and the Spirit. We offer thanksgiving and praise. And so, brethren, the Spirit leads us to joy and to thanksgiving at all times and for everything in the name of Lord. The verses 19 and 20 tells us, encourages us to show our reverence to God for all that he has given us. He has given us the breath of life. He has given us skill, abilities, and unique gifts. He has given us family. He has given us friends. He has given us time on the earth. What we do and how we live is how we honor God. Numbing ourselves with alcohol or a lack of empathy for others limits our ability to experience the fullness of life. And so, brethren, we see the passage is fairly clear. Paul is telling you, be careful of the consequences of your choices. And when you are careful about it, you allow the reflective component to come in. And so what lessons can we learn from this particular passage, brethren? I have just jotted down three important lessons that we can learn. The first lesson is, we have to carefully consider the consequences of our choices, understanding that easily human beings are driven by emotions. This may mean pausing and taking a deep breath before responding to a heated conversation or a surcharged atmosphere. I mean, it is good to tell someone, we'll come back to you on a decision we make. So when you make choices, brethren, it is important that you always consider the consequences of the choices. Let me share with you at this point an example. We all know how the story of David and Nabal. And what I want to emphasize is, how did David react to Nabal? You see, David was the king in waiting, and even though he's the anointed one, he's still on the run as Saul is hunting for his life. And so David and his 600 men are hunting in some remote valley, and they are desperately in need of food supplies. Nearby, there's a very rich man, a rich rancher, Nabal. And then it is a sharing time, and their celebrations are going on. So David sends his men with a request. He says, "Go meet Nabal and tell him over the months we have looked after your flock, we have looked after your men, and then we ensured that their safety and well-being. And please give us your free will gratuity for the voluntary services we rendered." And when Nabal heard it, Nabal was very upset. You all will remember that Nabal was a harsh and a cruel man, in contrast to his wife. His wife, Abigail, had both beauty and brains. So Nabal, just without listening, he rejected. He said, "I'm not going to help." Worse still is, he snubbed David. "Who is David?" he asked. And the news reaches David, and David is very upset. David, we all know, is a man of who had short fuse. And he immediately vows to come on them and finish the whole household. He made a decision, to finish the entire house. And so he called his soldiers and all of them are coming. As they are on the way, Abigail came to know about this news, and Abigail steps in. Now, Abigail was a lady, a very understanding lady. She knew ground realities. She also was able to use a reflective component well. And so she realized that David's request is just and fair. And so what she did was, she said, she embarked with her crew, and then to help David in their food supplies. And then she mediates, she comes to David, and then she observes all the protocol, humility and the decorum. And then she says, the mistake of not helping you is solely on my shoulders. She accepts responsibility. And she says, please don't do this. You are the anointed king. Please don't stain your hands with blood, and don't tarnish your image. You are the future king of this land. And David is touched by her. And David realizes, and he backtracks. He said, blessed are you whom the Lord has sent. Brethren, in this particular case, what we understand is David acted purely on emotional basis. He allowed the emotional component to reign supreme. Only when it was brought to his notice by Abigail, he stepped back and he stopped himself from wiping out the entire household. It must be said that the request is genuine, and in all fairness, it had to be considered. And that is what Abigail did it. So we have two contrasting cases here. We have the reaction of David, who acted on purely emotions. He did not take into consideration the consequences of his action, that he will be going contrary to God's laws, because the God's word says, do not take vengeance. I will repay, the Lord says. But David took upon it. And then you have the example of Abigail. Look at Abigail's reaction to this crisis management. She acted using both her emotional and her contemplative factors. Now let's move. And so the brethren, the first lesson that you and I need to always keep in mind is carefully consider the consequences of your choice, and understanding how easily human beings are driven by emotions. Let's move to the second lesson that we can learn. And the second lesson is prayerfully ask the Holy Spirit to guide you. This will take the shape of a contemplative prayer, which is more of an unveiling than a list of requests. Brethren, when we, you and I, ask God for wisdom, for insight, loving kindness, all this keeps the focus and the irrespective of the ultimate outcome of any decision. And we move into God's helping us to lead and to guide. So brethren, the second lesson that you and I have to remember is prayerfully, let's ask the Holy Spirit to guide us. We are always guided either by ourselves or by someone else. Let me share with you two contrasting examples. Let me juxtapose two contrasting examples. The one is a negative and the second is a positive. Let's take the negative example. It's about a young man near home. Many of you will remember whom I'm referring to. He was a dashing, dynamic, and a debonair young man. But he had some physical weakness, and he had a poor eyesight. One day, his doctor told him, friend, very soon you will be losing your eyesight. This particular, shocking news was too much. He couldn't take it. This young man could not take it. And so he told, how can I ever live being a burden to others? How can I ever be a burden to my would-be wife? And so he just throws in the towel, and thus comes to an end of a promising, budding life. and loved it. Let me give you another example, a positive example. We move across to the United States. It's the story about a little girl. A little girl, for no fault of hers, became a victim of cruelty. It so happened that she had an eye infection, and a quack attending on her messed up the case, and she lost her vision for the rest of her life. Brethren, but this particular girl did not take any extreme steps. She said, I'm sure she must have prayed, and she said, Lord, I am the victim of injustice and cruelty. Lord, I can't understand, I can't take it, but Lord, you take care of it, you lead me and guide me. And so she committed her life to the Father in heaven. And brethren, slowly but surely, she was on the road, not to physical recovery of eyesight, but she was going confident that God is with her. And she used her talents, and to make a long story short, she became a brilliant hymn composer. She is described as the queen of hymn composers. Her name is Fanny Crosby, late 19th century. Brethren, you all will remember the songs that we sing for across the world. Safe in the arms of Jesus, blessed assurance, I am thine, O Lord, to God be the glory. Fanny Crosby went on to write more than 8,000 songs. Brethren, what I want you to understand is Fanny Crosby depended on the Lord to guide her and take care of her. And so rather than throwing in the towel, Fanny Crosby became a blessing, not only to herself, but to thousands and thousands of Christians, both contemporary and in Christians to come, in the ages to come. And so, brethren, please let us remember that if we are to act wisely, we need to prayerfully ask the Holy Spirit to guide us. And surely God delights to ask us. One last lesson I want to share with you is incorporate gratitude for God's presence in our life. Just the other day, during our monthly intercessory prayers, I heard a member praying, Lord, thank you for the food you give us. Thank you for the shelter you give us. Thank you for the friends you give us. This particular prayer touched me. Here is a member who is grateful to all that God has given us. Brethren, you and I too need to recognize. We need to recognize the ordinary joys, like the morning coffee or the tea that we enjoy, a warm bath or the smile of our loved ones. And we offer prayers to God each day for what's bringing a smile to your life. Brethren, when you and I incorporate gratitude for God's presence in our life, we are on the right track, and God will lead you and guide you. Brethren, this particular passage in Ephesians 5, Paul is inviting us to think deeply about the choices you and I might exercise a God-given gift of free will in a most loving way. Too often, brethren, human beings hastily take decisions without considering the consequences. Brethren, God wants that you and I will be careful of the consequences of our decisions. You and I will pray for wisdom. You and I will notice the blessings around and be thankful. We forget. When we do this, brethren, we are treading on the right track, brethren. Carefully considering the consequences of our actions, and prayer, incorporating prayer and gratitude, helps us to enjoy this God-given gift of life in the here and now, and God's grace. Thank you, brethren. May God bless you all.